And this is how we titled our journal. It's called RabRab, Journal for Political and Formal Inquiries in Art. So today I will talk about this, how did I arrive to this question of importance of form in art in relation to politics. So first of all, the intervention was, or the reason to start with RabRab was to somehow challenge the status of political art. Usually people think that the political art has to be art which everybody understands, has to be art that changes certain situation in the social surrounding, and then usually this is labeled as activist art. And this assumes certain agency, certain way of doing this art that could make society better. See, so art in many cases, in these activist art examples, disappears. What is left is not an art, what is inherently, what is the most singular of the artistic practices and artistic theories, but instead we have something artist as a long hand of an NGO style dealing with social changes, dealing with politics and things like that. So how did I arrive to the question of form? First, I have to tell that I finished my PhD on Yugoslavian black wave cinema. It is a cinema movement active between 1963 with the first film Maidland and band called City Grad, and then end up in 1972 with the films of Dušan Makavejev and Lazar Stojanović and Želimir Žilnik, that they also got a problem with the state apparatuses. Okay, and this is the historical narrative of black wave cinema. And what I was looking at was a cultural politics of a black wave cinema. I did in the Department of Cultural Policy. That's associated with social science faculty and with the political science. And my plan was to look in which way the structures of support, let's say the financial support, the administration and all these things, which are also a big part of the filmmaking, influenced these films. And I put forward an argument that the artists who are involved in cultural policy, who are involved in, let's say, an explicit political struggles, also their form, also their, let's say, artistic expressions become richer. You see, usual approach in sociology of art, let's say, what Pierre Bourdieu wrote, for example, was this concept of disinterestedness. Like, artists are uninterested in the real structures of the how art is supported in the cultural policy, let's say. So they are like declaring this kind of autonomy out of in relation to the society and the structures, and working in their art as sort of anomaly to a society. Though, when we look more carefully, let's say in the film, but it is also possible to stretch to art, those artists who are interested into cultural policy, who are interested in the way of financing, way of distribution and representation, actually were facing the very concrete contradictions. Because if you are in certain commissions, if you take a part in the commissions as an artist, as one art filmmaker from Yugoslavia called Dušan Makavejev, which is one of my main focus, he was a member of some 5 or 10 commissions. He was a member of commission for introducing a film in the education institutions. it's called commission for a film Idete. And then he was in part of the commission for disseminating the culture to youth, let's say. He was involved in the commission for a cultural affairs of voluntary labor. At that time in 50s and 60s was important, like constructing the Yugoslavia after the war. Anyway, so what I looked was these discussions happening between in that commissions. There were some transcripts published because some important figures were involved and some sociology journals published those. Some edited, some unedited, or in archives I found things that were not published. What was my PhD methodologically, what I wanted to do in my research was how to detect these discussions, that intellectual, political discussions that happen in commissions, how they reflected or refracted, actually better, into their artwork. And I find out, and I find that actually that did reflect a lot. I don't know if you know the films of Dušan Makavejev. For example, his films are like, and he was influenced by Czech New Wave, let's say, but seems were more radical. Maybe this Vera Kitilova's film is Daisy's most closer. He did a film on Wilhelm Reich called Mysteries of Organism, quite a subversive film. And there is a book by Amos Vogel called Subversive Film Cinema. It's like a list of thousands of subversive films made in all around the world. And cover is Dušan Makavejev's film, VR. It's a very strong political film about one Russian ice skater visiting Yugoslavia and facing the sexual liberation there. And then through Wilhelm Reich's theories, German psychoanalyst who was analyzing fascism, sexuality, and psychoanalyst. Yes, it's a strange film, so to say, but anyway, so then the theoretical apparatus, the methodology to trace the influence of intellectual discussions or political discussions or what was happening historically at that moment and how those discussions take place in the artwork are very limited, especially if you follow the theories of cultural policy and sociological aspect. They are very deterministic and in a sense very vulgaristic, reducing actually artistic complexities to just very easily explainable determinations, you know, like, yeah, because, I mean, let's say like this, yeah, because Yugoslavia in the 70s was non-aligned and did it both like a Western and the Eastern impacts and live in that such an antagonistic situation, so films reflect both parts. You know, if you explain like that, you miss the real point. And what's the real point of the art? It's, they are actually forms, you see. So this is how I understood that without studying forms, the formal properties of art, of the artwork, it is difficult to even understand the social impact. For of course, it is impossible to understand the singularity of art, what makes art, but also it is difficult to understand that dialectics. And then, I pursued this methodological research. So for me, most important thing in studying formalism was Russian formalist, of course. And this is quite obsolete if in 2010, 14, 16, you refer to Viktor Shklovsky, who wrote in 1915, 1917, 1925, or to Jakobson, or to Tinyanov, or to Eichenbaum, or to Mukhajovsky in Prague, you know. It sounds like, well, what about contemporary things, you see? Though my position was not to take a readily granted formalist approach, how it was read, even though they made the analysis of the cinema works, but just that decision that in order to understand the political aspect of the artwork, we never should forget a formal aspect. So, let's say intellectually, to add one more layer to this. That's why for my research, formalism was methodologically, or let's say, theoretically more important. You know, you take a decision, I go also to forms. And it makes a very complicated than the approach you decide to have. And in 70s and 80s, there was a lot of Marxists, leftists, or let's say post-Marxist art historians, art critics, who also were involved in making clear that historical, political influences to artworks. I mean, there is Colin Mercer, Pierre Macherey, let's say, from France, all the semioticians, Yuri Lotman, and I mean, you just name it. That was the actual main, the pillar of the art theory in 70s and 80s. T.G. Clark, you probably know if you are interested in art history, who made a research on Gustave Courbet. I mean, this was the thing in the 70s and 80s, and what they came to conclusion that you don't find the determinations, but you find inscriptions. What traces politics leave in the art. And thing is that traces politics leave to art, you could understand only if you look from the point of view of art, which means if you know that language of art that has its own law, own evolution, not necessarily corresponding to what is happening in society. Has its own jumps, cuts, breaks, lines, and this. So for me, studying Russian formalism was quite important, and that very much introduced me that the issue of contradiction, see. I mean, I could talk more about my research on Yugoslavian cinema and especially Dušan Makavejev. So what I studied, for example, in Makavejev, I didn't study his films so much, what he did, but I studied slogans. What kind of slogans, what role slogans played in Makavejev's films, but in order to understand that, I asked the question, what was the theory of Makavejev about slogans? What theory he had on slogans when he was incorporating them into his artwork, into his films? Certainly, he had some, because nobody makes artwork without having a theory, without having the position toward certain, whether it is language, in this case, language, of course, slogans, or whether it is history, or whether it is body, or other things. You must have an idea. And this theory is very much from the artistic lines comes. Makavejev, for example, wrote a book in 64, actually just the year when he made first feature film called Kisses for a Comrade Slogan. Small booklet, it's a collection of his texts from the 50s that he describes his own involvement in this voluntary brigades building the big highway called Brotherhood and Unity. And there he has a theory that actually good slogan has to contain a Dadaistic element. The rational, logical slogan does not have that influence as a strange slogan has. You know, this is very much in line with Shklovsky's theory of ostranjenje, this defamiliarization, estrangement. You see, something has to be very strange there, very upside down, so to make the effect even more stronger. This, so looking at the formal aspect of the artworks allowed me to enter to these things, because, and there are a few books on Makaveyev, few articles, many articles actually. A lot of famous people wrote on Makaveyev, famous film and art theoretician. But nobody went, in fact, through this field of slogans. And also a big part of my research was to understand why. And I think that's the ideological reasons. Ideological reasons, because people differentiate, yes, Makaveyev dealt with sexuality, with a body, so he was not interested in forms, and those, he was more intuitive and open to a spontaneous outburst, whatever, you know, like, so this description is, there is a Godard, Calvinist, rationalist, and here is Makaveyev, Dionysiac, you know, illogical. Though in that illogic of Makaveyev, there was very strong logic. That was like, let's say, that is my general theoretical position. And through that, I analyze also other, maybe not so interesting, but can be interesting, very technical things, representation of mud in the films. In one, I took one example, Živojin Pavlović. If you know 60s New Wave films from Czechoslovakia, there are a lot of muds also, like, because it is, mud represents this blato. It represents between city and the village, not total emancipation from the village life. Like, sociologically, mud is a metaphor, you see? It's metaphor of, we actually are not yet arrived to this cosmic, futuristic socialism, but we are still in our feudal past. I mean, one feet is in the mud, you know? Like, if you look at the books written by the Western scholars on the socialism, you can see like some muddy things there, somebody walking with the boots, and in the city there is a mud, you know. Yes, okay, metaphoric sociology, but any cinematographer, filmmaker knows one thing, to shot the mud, you have to have a theory of mud as well. So what I did with Živojin Pavlović, I looked what in fact they understood from the mud. You know, like, you can say, it is easy to say, yeah, mud is sociological, this and that, mud is metaphor, is this. But this is simplification. Because when you make a film, film doesn't happen just like that. You know, there are like how the darkness of the mud, it's coming into a film. And on top of it, how do you relate as a narrative to the mud? You see, like, there's so many technical, so many, let's say, representational problems that even from looking from the to mud, you can find theories of montage. It will open to you to understand the theories of montage of certain film direct. That text of mine is called Mud as a Device. Anyway. So formalism as such is interesting to study, I recommend to you all. And the Russian formalists, why they are important? Because when they came as a literature methodology, they came with an agenda. It was not just academics who said like, yeah, this methodology is wrong, let's choose to other methodology. No, they were against first symbolists, very much into this kind of metaphoric content, you know, and formalists wanted completely to challenge how actually history is understood. like history of certain literature genres. You know, they were angry. But what is the most amazing in their contribution to a theory and the methodology is what they research. They research the most advanced artworks, poetries, of Russian futurists. So what happened? You have Roman Jakobson, who didn't start by researching Pushkin or somebody, but start by researching Khlebnikov, or Khrushchev, or Mayakovsky, Malevich. You know, Malevich was writing poems as well. So they went to the most radical examples of art, knowing that artists actually know the best what they do. If anybody, if you want to learn a business, if you want to learn the job, like which is writing the poem, making the film, don't talk to sociologists. Don't talk to historian, talk to artist. They are one who do, and ones who realize things, and wants to prepare the things for realization, for execution. So go and talk with them, hang with them, learn from them. But this is what formalists did. And why the most experimental ones? Because, of course, that was the position at that time, that futurist poems, the Zaun, for example, are poems that completely dissect the language. Language is cut into little pieces and exposed and thrown to the table. Here is what we have in our hand. And that's why. So, and also that they were angry. They were angry about existing situation, about conservatism, and wanted something new. We talk about 1913, 1915, you know, before revolution. So, yeah, there are many things to talk about this, but what is the most interesting is that what formalists discovered on language, then they went to apply to the classics, to canons, to Pushkin, Tolstoy, Gogol, and, you know, we talk about Russians here. And also with Shklovsky, also to Stern, this Tristram Shandys, British writers from 17th century. What is the thing that you learn, thing from the art, and you from today, and you make a methodology, and you can then apply and discover things that nobody else realized that this. This line of thinking also existed, let's say, in Pushkin. Okay, I jumped, this was like 20, then in the thing with the formalists is that after Russian Revolution, after 1917, October Revolution, let's say, things become more problematic. Like, what's the now, the relation of the demanding, very highly demanding current social situation to that intrinsic, formal, experimental, formal inquiry research. That dispersed formalists. Some managed to get very interesting outcomes out of it. Tinyanov, I would say, Boris Arvatov, Sergei Tretiakov, you know, they were also doing art things, and Eisenstein. Actually, Shklovsky is right when he says, if there was not Mayakovsky, there would be no Eisenstein. That's the thing. And Mayakovsky also grasped the welcomed revolution. Not everybody did. Jakobson went, he came here in Prague. Shklovsky escaped, was depressed, came back, you know, because he was socialist revolutionary group which tried to kill Lenin and assassinate German ambassador. Anyway, so there was a problem there. But this question of formalism and Marxism is actually very tempting question. I will not go so deep into it. I'm sure this kind of things were translated in Czech language, because we talk about Karel Taige, very much these last 2 days we are talking, like his writings directly touches upon that question of formal, experimental, artistic positions and the Marxism and the historical materialism and being resolutely against bourgeois concept of art and the art market. Anyway, so this is also available in English. I have a Serbo-Croatian formalism and Marxism collection of texts. Like if you look at here, you can see such a contradictory things, such a unresolvable tensions. And let's leave it there as it is. I don't want to go so much deep into that. Because, you know, one thing is, one question between form and formalism is, of course, content. Formalists were against, like they said, listen, content is important in the artwork. But what really makes artwork an artwork is a form. And no new form comes because there is a new content now suddenly, but because the previous old forms are dead, not valid anymore. That's the logic of the formalism. But the problem is this, that it is not only art which operates through forms, it's also politics. If you read Karl Marx, for example, if you read his Civil War in France, his analysis of the Paris Commune, he comes up with a thing called commune form. 1871. And commune form, exactly this is how Marx says, it's a very political description. It's not commune as a cultural, artistic, aesthetical thing. It is something which is unprecedented, just arrived suddenly out of blue. Nobody expected that that would be such an organization. So he tries to understand that, in fact, theory lagged behind what happened in the streets. And he put it as a commune form. So form is also in the politics. What I want to say, the tension between art and politics cannot be reduced to form and content, you know? Politics is not a content, whereas art is a form. Because usual description, what Russian formalists gave to relationship between form and content was this, like they give this example. Before, people were thinking that content is water, or juice, or beer, whatever you have, and then there is a glass, which is a form where you pour the content. You know, no, they intervened and said that both glass and the water and the pouring activity or drinking activity is a form. It's very dialectical thing. You know, that's the first starting point. So I am moving to one concrete example, which is first publication that we did that that is made as a rub-rub press. I will talk about what does it mean, rub-rub, and what is all about, but... So, in 2014, I was in Georgia, in Tbilisi, 2 months doing residency at GeoAir. And I worked together often with the artist Mina Henriksson. So, there, what I looked, I made a small publication. Unfortunately, there was no copies to bring, only one, which I don't bring. It's a 50 pages, small A5 booklet. I will show now PDF. It's called Still Stealing Steel, Historical Materialist Study of Zaum. Zaum in Russian means beyond logic, beyond sense. And that was the poetry made by futurists. And some of them were Georgians, like Ilias Danevich, most famous, who was a innovative designer, also very advanced experimental designer, typographist, and graphic designer. So, but what happened in 1917, when after October Revolution, Mensheviks, you know this fight, Bolsheviks and Mensheviks, Mensheviks who were not for the for a direct revolution, insurrection. They were for slowly with more like social democrats, more like left social democrats, you know. Could think of negotiation with other political groups, could even consider the entering parliament. So 1917 revolution breaks in the Russia, and then Mensheviks managed to make a revolution in Georgia, and there was a Menshevik revolution in Georgia. And most of these futurists moved to Tbilisi because it's warm, Mensheviks are okay, you know, not so, it was more, let's say, easy life. Who was there? There was like a main person in the main theoretician and the main writer of the Russian futurist, Alexei Krushonik, moved and lived in Tbilisi. This was for me important thing to understand that, okay, this is experimental artists, designers, theater, film, but mostly poems, poets, came to place, and now we are seeing them in the different social surrounding. How that happens? I wanted to look at really just at that relationship between politics and experimental art. But what is interesting is that Georgia is a full with contradictions. Georgia is extremely anti-communist place. For example, in Georgia, it is impossible to use sickle and hammer. It's criminalized. Sickle and hammer is as criminalized as swastika. And like in Poland. So, but in Georgia, it is the only place where there is a Stalin museum. It's in Gori, where Stalin was born. And it is a museum same as it was established in the 1950-something, after Stalin's death. It's really only one room cellar, which is sort of critical of totalitarianism. Otherwise, it's the same, intact, like same museum as it was in the initiated over glorification of Stalin, of course. And then before we arrived, like months before, there was apparently big statue also in Stalin, in Gori, and they removed it. In the night time police, because people would go crazy and next day they rioted for that statue. So it's very strange place. You have like anti-communism, Stalin cult, and then you have the Mensheviks, you have this Georgian-ness, this national pride. And then I have looked how in fact this avant-garde or contemporary artists, art theoreticians deal with that past. And it was very problematic. So many of the researchers are seeing a Georgian futurism as something a part of their glorious past, of them being intrinsically democratic, tolerant, not like Moscow and Bolsheviks, but this was, if it led to develop by itself, by its logical necessity, you know, Georgia would be like any other European country. So this is a discourse. And this is very much related to my previous work and publication on relationship between contemporary art and nationalism. Anyway, but so this is a book, what is a result of a residency. And another thing, to do such a book, as I said, like if you do a film on MADS or on slogans, you have to have a theory of slogans. So when we went to the residency, I actually had a theory of residency. I don't know what theory you have, but artist residencies, you know, it's a very, very strange position, because you as an artist, you are invited, let's say, in Tbilisi, or in Stockholm, or in Vienna, or in some Kosovo, or I don't know where not. There are everywhere residencies. And what is expected from artists are to go and to immerse themselves into this locality and to get something almost as an anthropologs. You know, like, yeah, now we find the specificity, and rarely it is encouraged that a critical thought will be somehow emerged out of it. This is art and language, conceptual art group called this as a Trobriand Island syndrome, something like that, which means, like, they give example, imagine of anthropologists who go to some Trobriand Island and they don't know anything about it. So what is the first step? First step is you say, yeah, these people are like that. They are right what they do because they are different from us, you know, and I have to accept this is a situation. You accept what is given in the residency field and you just work. But no, this is very ideological position of the artist residence. You can confront this if you have another theory. You can say, no, this is not normal. This is ideological, first of all. No place is functionally perfect because they are others, they have their own values. So my project is very critical. About even I was in Georgia invited, the way how this legacy and relationship between Mensheviks, experimental art is used today. There are very strange things in this book I want to show briefly. So it starts with some quotation from Lawrence Stern, Sentimental Journey, and then there is a theory of Zaum. So my starting point is that, yes, Zaum, beyond sense, but has some logic. And this logic is bringing a noise, the event of the noise to put forward, you know. And then declaring the word class struggles, trying to find out what actually it is that, what makes a word so rich with a possibilities, potentials. It's actually coercion, contradictions. That inside the word, class struggles are happening. This is a theory by Valentin Voloshinov, who is maybe Bakhtin or maybe not. He has a book called Philosophy of Marxist Philosophy of Language. He was then killed by Stalin in 1936. But, so this is it. And then to ask a question, is dictatorship of proletariat a Zaum word, you know? Is the dictatorship of proletariat a word which was so strong as a slogan, not because of a content necessarily, let's say in English, but because of form as well. There are three R's here, you know, three R's which are, R was studied by the Russian formalists as a very strong consonant which with a very peculiar rhythm, they study the kind of rhythms of the consonants, and Boris Arvatov and other Russian formalists looked at the political slogans and discussed if the very form of these slogans make them so strong. And I was asking, so if it's so, is it dictatorship of proletariat, some kind of strong thing? I mean, there is a lot of jokes here. And then there are some analysis of scatological issues in Zaum. You know, like what is cut down the poem is kaka, you know, like shitty things. So, but what I found in Georgia, there is a big. Georgia, mother of Georgia, it's like a very patriotic, nationalistic sculpture. And then somebody wrote this Marcel Duchamp's graffiti, L-H-O-O-Q-L-A-S-H-O-K-U-L, which means she's hot in her ass. Somebody just wrote that, you know, that's not me. So there is a Tbilisi affair, and this is a very interesting moment when Althusser was invited to come to Tbilisi and give a lecture on unconsciousness. In 1977, in Tbilisi, there was a huge conference on unconsciousness, and it came out as a 4 books like this. You see, the unconsciousness psychoanalysis in Russia was banned, like was not so much supported by, but in Tbilisi they managed to organize such a conference. And Althusser's thing, which he didn't go to Tbilisi, but he sent a paper, and it's called The Discovery of Dr. Freud in its Relations with Marxist Theory. It's a very crude text. For example, I talk with Mladen Dolar, maybe you know, theoretician, who write also on Althusser and on Lacan. He said this is Althusser's worst text. He tries to understand certain class background of the unconsciousness, and I mean, it is interesting text. So this is generally the publication with many different quotations, a lot of swear words, you know. What really made the Zaum book so strong was swear words. I said scatological, but also a lot of fuck and this kind of thing. And these are some graffitis. We wrote down like, fuck you, fucking fuck, explaining what is fuck. But then there is very interesting things from Bakhtin about the poetics of Dostoevsky, when he explains that, you know, he has a, is this quotation, I cannot read so much, but he has a quotation, I know this is from the Mladen Dolar, here is a quotation of how like a 5 or I don't know how many drunk people are talking same word, but they all understand. It's a funny story from the Dostoevsky, actually something very nasty, some word, but everybody kind of managed to communicate just saying one word each. I mean, this is a question of the property of a word. See, word is so rich with a history that is sedimented in its formation that can explode to many directions, can explode to futurity. And now this was futuristic theory, yes, of the word. That word announced the future, what will happen if you really look at the words. And I found now a text published by Roman Jakobson, who later on went to US, became professor, very famous on linguistics, on the sound and the meaning. Anyway, in 1938, he published in Prague a text in one journal, which is a collection of a poetic and some other literature examples that prophesized revolution. Mayakovsky knew already in 1914 that in 17 will be revolution. Khlebnikov, others. I think Zamyatin, I don't know what now. But so this is the thing. I mean, this is very maybe a shortcut to explain the what actually is meant with the futurity of the image, of the word, I'm sorry. But what is most interesting here, that if we say that class struggles take place inside the word, a word is not symmetrical. There is some asymmetry inside the word, inside the language, some inherent asymmetry. I made a book together with Minna Henriksson exactly about that, Noise After Babel. It's I leave here copies. It deals with property of words in the multiculturalism. And in fact that we real thing what is of importance in the linguistic aspects of the artworks or anything, you know, of language, is that contradictions, that noise. Something it's not so easily to translate, something it's not easily to fit to already available packages, form like forms, let's say. So I found it very stupid, very misleading to use futuristic poetry for such a nationalistic aspirations as the futurist words are for against totalitarianism. You know, totalitarianism is a really empty concept, means nothing, means this absolutism, means a very religious understanding of the political situation. And so it was intervention to that. And then there is a trying to historicize the most famous Zaum by Krushonik, Dur Bul Shul. And there are some 7-8 variations. How different people understood that thing in completely different way. This is Dur Bul Shul, Dirala Birala Shilala, it's how it synced, means nothing. It's really no nonsense. And many people kind of try to dig out some sense out of it. So I built some historiography, let's denies the historicist, evolutionist understanding. You see, it's a bit conceptual. Anyway, so this is it, the first publication. And related to it, I can briefly mention another publication, very briefly. It's a result earlier in 2012, published by Labyrinth Press. Work with Minna Henriksson. We were a guest of a residency in the suburb in Stockholm called Fittja. And we tried to understand the riots that took place, race riots. So, because usually residency things are like that. If you are invited to the multicultural residency places, you as an artist are expected to find some values there. See, values like, which means there are these Kurdish, Arabs, Turks, whatever, you know. They are like knowing how to cook something nice, how to take care of gardens, some beautiful things, you know, something like very much of reducing the creativity to things that people anyway do. Baking, you see, it's a very ordinary things. But we wanted to look something where this ordinary, banal, everyday life is cut through, and it was a riot, very violent situation when the people from that part of the, it was the most unemployed town, place in the old Sweden. I don't know, 70% people living there unemployed. It's like horror, you know, it's dystopia. It's not Sweden, but you are 25 minutes from the sub Gamlastan, center of Stockholm. Anyway, so we didn't want to look at these people who are living there, but we wanted to look at the researchers who look at them. And why actually they tend to look in the way they look. You know, this agency of like immigrants and stuff. I forgot to say the structure of it. We were invited by the art Kunsthalle, one Kunsthalle, who collaborate with the Multicultural Research Center in that place, and there are researchers and the residency organization. So you know, artists are expected to go to residence in that place, talk with the researchers, as if artists cannot do research themselves, cannot have ideas, but have to hear what anthropologists say about situation, you know, and then only the depict the situation. This is not artistic inquiry and research. So we criticize certain few things, violence, issue of spontaneity. You know, everybody asks, these Arabs are crazy, these Kurds are maniacs. They are like destroying the kindergartens we built for them. What you built? You built, but you didn't build. And because Sweden has the best representative laws for the multiculturalism, that means foreign, like, immigrants are really represented in the state, but something is not letting them to enjoy their legal rights. So, hey, man, this is it. Our symbol is, how we can make it this two page, is it possible? Likely, no. So, two spreads in the same. Nastroje?
Yes.
Zobrazi?
Jo,
pardon.
Yes.
Somehow stuck now, yeah. Okay, doesn't matter, you know, it's okay. So I will show like this, maybe it will be clear. This is from, that's why the book is called La Fontaine Stories for Immigrants. You know La Fontaine? Story when the fox invites the stork, huh? And gives the food, everything is there, but there is a big, which does not let her, it's always bird is she, to eat the thing there. And this was so important, this representation, this image. And this is usually how immigrants are represented, as a bird. They are more spontaneous, they are like a free as a bird. They are amazing, you know, like this Superflex group made poster, Danish people, please don't leave us alone with a... No, pardon, immigrants, please don't leave us alone with dance. You know, immigrants are so colorful, so amazing, you know, our Swedes are boring and stuff like that. But what is this? This is a very identity-based understanding. Anyway, so this is a book like that, trying to figure out Frantz Fanon. It's one line is Frantz Fanon, another line are critique of spontaneity through Althusser. And then we made a big research on the how in the art discourse, spontaneity is kind of discussed, even like in Ctodelat and some other. Here is Gillo Pontecorvo, Fanon's, based on Fanon, Battle in Alger. So anyway, this is a thing, another kind of project dealing with the issue of residences. So these questions, these issues of form and politics, all that what I mentioned so far, kind of, and what I said, artists' knowledge, both kind of, I would not say pushed, but somehow lead my intellectual position to make it more clear, more concrete steps, you know. And then I realized that there are in the world many people who think like us, which means think that political art should not be simple, banal art. Political art should not be art looking, working as NGO, as some Greenpeace activism and stuff like that. Political art should never forget art, you know, the forms, the experiments, the advancement of the forms and things like that. So we started a journal called RabRab, 2014. RabRab is completely arbitrary. RabRab comes from Konrad Lorenz, It's an ethologist from Austria, won Nobel Prize. He studied the behavior of animals. And he has a book, very reactionary book, called On Aggression, where he explains ducks' behavior. Like when they pair, men, male duck, drake, approach to female duck and shows all the signs of aggression. So inviting for pair, you know, pairing, but says one different, rub-rub. That word is different, that rub-rub is calling for making love. And then this aggression, love, rub-rub, and this repetition is the title, nothing. But what was for us very important is the antagonisms. You know, I'm very interested in that. Of course, everyday life things as well, but antagonisms, contradictions, revolts, insurrections, riots, things interest me a lot because in that moment, very rich, very dense social fabric erupts. So heuristically, I mean, thing that we can learn from artistically, these are very important moments, you know. The first, we start with the epigram from Alain Badiou, says, the only lesson from which there is no returning back is the lesson of antagonism. Once you go to antagonism, once you clash, confront, there is no returning back. It's a big transformation. You cannot now come back as if it didn't happen. It's always step forward. You see. And I read a few things because this is sort of manifesto of ours. I started this journal with a French guy called Grégoire Rousseau, and we authored this together. It says, the reason for this new journal on art is an intervention in the existing field. Rub-rub is an attempt to clear out the way for the expressions which we believe are necessary in order to formulate a different artistic practice. Ultimately, the reason originates from need for intervention to all let represent the most reactionary and uninteresting things in art, namely the phenomenological, mystical, depoliticized, functional, populist, nationalist, and provincialist positions. These positions are currently prevailing in most fields of artistic productions. They encourage the shape to art which is easily traceable in its contours, from capitalist optimism to paranoid social relations, and all the way to euphoria of national competition. See, we were like making sort of lines here. And why a form and politics? Because first, our theoretical position is that any work based on contradictions of formal properties of art production will lead to politics and vice versa. Hence, the involvement with political contradictions will disclose the heurism of intelligible through forms. That's why there is correspondence between political formations and patterns of production. You see, if you really are into political struggle, your form will get enriched. But also if you really go into how things work, what are the formal structural properties of, let's say, even experimental film, something, you will in the end come to institutions, come to politics, come to things that are not necessarily part of the artistic discourse, you know. And secondly, the relation between form and politics is a technical one, as form can be a point of departure for learning activity in artistic productions. It is also a finite definition of reproduction. See, form is a drawing the line. This is the limit, you know. You cannot jump everywhere. As Roman Jakobson described their methodology, said that formalists came to a scene because they were fed up with old literature theoreticians that were eclecticism, jumble of things, you know, little bit biography, little bit psychologism, little bit history, little bit statistic, little bit intuition. He said, this looks like a detective from Scotland Yard who knows that in this apartment, his examples are always funny, there is a thief, and so to make it sure, he takes everybody to a prison and then, you know, find out, sorting out the situation. But formalists go to more, you know, limiting the where actually you go. So this limitless, putting a constraints to your intellectual capacity and activity is important. It's not simplification, don't understand me wrong, but at least know where you are, what you do. So that's why form. And in the end, we say this, it's very funny. To a mouse, there is no stronger beast than the cat, wrote Lenin, criticizing Rosa Luxemburg. Do you know this? Lenin criticized Rosa Luxemburg because Rosa Luxemburg was very much against nationalism. Any kind of nationalism for her was a reaction. Even if it was a nationalism of progressive sort, of a sort of workers' struggle and stuff. So Lenin said, no, I mean, nationalism, if it's something emancipatory, like Fanon, for example, African nationalism, Amilcar Cabral, who will say to Amilcar Cabral he's reactionary, or Fanon, I mean, or Ngugi Wa Thiong'o, or the other, you know. So he said, he made this to Maus, there is no stronger beast than the cat, because Rosa Luxemburg was obsessed in one particular socialist fraction in Poland at that time, who were extremely nationalist. So for her beast was that cat, you know, that she was, but there are bigger picture, that was a joke. So we also, wrote here, have to be careful not to lose sight of everything else in our struggle. Against, I didn't read that, we are very much against provincialism. I mean, I'm based in Helsinki, and Helsinki, I don't know how much you are familiar with the Nordic countries' cultural scene, is devastatingly provincial. I mean, far more provincial. Even there is a huge money, huge means, most of the artists have the stipendias who are like, I don't know, 2,000 euro a month or something. Like an artist has a really very relaxed situation economical, but production is amazing, provincial, nationalistic, chauvinistic, apolitical and things like that. So we also have to be careful not to see all world through Finland, you know. So we are hoping that RABRA will be a platform for discussing everything that ideological blindness has swept away. And we hope to contribute both in theory and in practice to the struggle against liberal capitalist paranoia, which is about to become a dominant language of art. We don't do this only for the sake of love of art. We have other struggles too. But we think that without legacy of contemporary art, we would not be here. That's what I think. Our slogan is that the goodwill is not enough for this position. Or as Art and Language said, having your heart in the right place is not making history. We intend to disturb the place given to us. You know, this is it. Always there are places where you are expected to be. And me, for example, now I go a bit to biography. Me as a Kosovar, working in Finland from Yugoslavia, I was expected, and any project I applied was supported, to do things regarding how terrible it is life in Balkans, or showing this craziness of Balkans. You know, this Igor Zabel wrote very much about this, V and others, and it's very Renata Saletzel, very interesting things like what is expected from those periphery artist to be, I mean, like Kosovar guy, you know, you have to do something about nationalism, independence, something, which I did. Very critical, very Marxist things though. And then So this journal didn't get any support. We did without own money. But then after when it came as such an intervention, we got something to publish this third, second and third issue. And now we got a more substantial grants to publish books. That's our economical situation. Though we have everything transparent. You see, we have like here, I will leave this like four or five issue here, a financial statement describing in details money, where it came, where it went. So it's not big monies, you will see. But nobody is paid. That's how we survive. Only designer gets some very symbolic fee, and proofreader, translator. So it's really a work. And the first issue was dealing with a question of language, and we are happy to have an introductory text by John Roberts. You are familiar with this art theoretician. He published very good books from Verso on the avant-garde, on the precarity, on deskilling, photography also, yes. So he wrote something about writerliness. You know, I have to tell a policy of journal. In the RabRab journal, there are no texts about other artists. Like it is forbidden to publish somebody to publish explaining other artists' work. Only artists write about their own works, mostly, or things that were part of their research. We are resolutely against representing the others and playing this mediator role. So we are, in that sense, against curatorial practice as well as curator being a mediator, you know. Apart from the institutional role, the objective role of the curator, there is not much what the curators add in the theoretical discourse. Okay, why something like this? Anyway, so first issue, here are some, I don't know if you can read, but I can read John Roberts. Then there are a few analyses of slogans. I made the artwork. Sometimes I do artworks. And this was about Lenin's language. It's a machine I built with two discs. It's complicated to explain, but it would have been easier to show. So it's a two disc. In the front, there are like separated into five equal fields of tendentials and fields of applications. So these are fields of tendentials, are known things related to Lenin, like materialism, abstraction, barbarism, I have contingency, force, and field of application, space, noise, time, signals, and which place, 99. Yeah, it's here, the table. You cannot see anything. Anyway, so you move the front disc, which has the holes, and each are differently in the different colors painted, and you move one field corresponding to another field, like let's say materialism to a noise, and you have A2, and you open the booklet, and of course, because hole will arrive in a different position, and there will be different indications like materialism is a not dead dog or something like that. And these are all quotations, very strange, very unusual quotations from Lenin or things about Lenin, trying to show that the most interesting things about Lenin regarding art, it's not the things that he wrote on art, but in some other very unusual things. So this is it. I mean, it's also to do with the theory of slogans. Did you read the Mille Plateaux, Thousand Plateaus of Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari? In that book, there is a chapter called Postulates of Linguistics. And they claim that every language is a declarative. So we talk with the slogans, word orders. And if you remember, the main, let's say, theoretical position for them to come up with such a thesis was writing of Lenin in 1917, I don't know what date, 27th of July 1917, called On Slogans. He develops a theory, said every slogan is a condensation of a theoretical analysis of a contingent situation. Something happens, like, for example, Soviets must take the power, was valid. Every slogan is a condensation of the observation, theoretical observation, but it's valid only for a certain period of time. Slogans has a temporality. He says, slogans, these slogans, one, doesn't matter, was valid from 4th of April to 27th of July. After that, it's finished. So this temporality, in fact, this passage of a slogans and its collective enunciation, and on top of it, as a condensation of a theory, was a backbone for Deleuze and Guattari. And this thing deals with that a bit. Then the Minna Eriksson text on swastika in Finland, it's still on use, swastika in Finland. It's on use in the Finnish Air Force. And this is presidential, the president's cross they give to very important people. Only one person refused to take it. No, two. De Gaulle and Tito. But others who go to Finland and are renowned guests, they take and there is fucking swastika, you know. So she made like, this is it. And she made the research, what actually this swastika is. Everybody explains like, but this swastika came to Finland with Galen Kalela in the late 19th century. It has nothing to do with Nazism, you know. This is something sans swirl, something archaic. No way. It's like when you, so what she did, asked to 30 researchers, historians, whatever, scientists, and they, as a reference of use of swastika, they give Wikipedia as a source because it's, they are so desperate, you know, so like lost in this case. And nobody can say this is them swastika of the Second World, of the Nazi ideology, because swastika became a white suprematist symbol already in 1870s. And these guys who were taking into Finland in the paintings in 1880s saw this big swastika mania in Paris because they were Paris, and she traced all these things. And they say another thing. Finland had a big civil war in 1918 between whites and reds after the October after the Russian Revolution, after their independence, which was given by Lenin. Anyway, so they got whites, got a plane from some count, aristocrat guy, who gave a plane to whites to bomb the reds. And they had a swastika here, blue swastika. This guy, some von Rosen, is not anybody. His sister was married to Goebbels. You know, psycho, you are like, okay, guy. And so there are like thousands of these coincidences, like, what? What swastika? This is direct link with National Socialism. Even it's predate, because they say, hey, but National Socialism won in 1933. Whatever before happened before that, it was like just like something random. You know, as if National Socialism fell from the sky, you know. And so this was very provocative. This text was very much kind of, as they say, hit the nail, you know. And what other interesting things are in this publication? Manuela Unverdorben, maybe you know her. She's active also as in the... Vladan Jeremic. Text about Roma peoples, referring to Pasolini, but how Roma people are used in Italy by the capitalists companies, you know, by the rich companies, in collaboration with the state for almost colonization. It's very interesting. But one thing I want to show, yes, Manuela Unverdorben, she made a research of declassified documents on Yugoslavia, now released by CIA, and she made a narrative of that document. It's beautiful to read. It's really this how CIA thought. And another interesting thing here is this correction to the text on Studi II, written by Stockhausen's, one of the most important electronic pieces from early 50s, Study. And it is a mathematical, you know what, how he worked, mathematical music, like serial music, anything. And Shinji Kanki is an experimental musician based in Helsinki, original from Japan, very interesting person. He found mistake in that composition, you see. He found mistake that Stockhausen made a wrong calculation in some algorithms. And he wrote to Stockhausen Foundation, who had to accept that actually, yes, this composition is wrong. But this is a strange thing. I mean, how you can criticize a subjectivity of artwork? Is there such a thing? For him, it's not that important. This is only a scientific part of it. What is he interested is the contemporary reading of Stockhausen, which silences the noises. You know, this digital and very reactionary, conservative uses of Stockhausen. There is also interesting text about punk in New York and their relationship with the conceptual art, this no-wave punk. And last text is also was very controversial text by a Finnish research artist who wrote a very thorough analysis of what does it mean, artistic research? Do you have in, is there in Czech now PhD here in Prague, artistic research? In Finland is a big thing. People call themselves, I am artistic researcher. You know, it's as if like, it's no art, no research, it's nothing. And when, so what Kalle Lampela did, he looked what they think, what they describe in their articles, in their publications, is artistic research, is actually anything what artist does, is a spontaneity, is this ideological things. Like if you make yoga, and one artist, actually what pissed him off was that one artist was closing library from 9 to 11 on Wednesdays in the morning, you know, and making yoga as her artistic research. So it was her artistic research. And then so like what? I mean, if this is artistic research, then why? What guarantees the inquiry, the research? Only the agency that you are artist. It's so ideological, it's so problematic. So this is a very nice text, ridiculizing that. And then we made second issue came as a 2 volumes. It deals with the question of noise. You have these copies here. Question of noise, which is very important for us, that is that contradictions. In these issues, there are a lot of things about music, obviously, because it's about noise, sounds. So there is like Dörfeiler, you know, Dörfeiler, maybe you might not know, he's based in Stockholm. And I made interview with him while working on that Stockholm multiculturalism project. He is a free jazz musician. And he played in the 3 bands, like Iskra was called one, Locomotive Concrete, Too Much Too Soon, really good improvised already from the 70s. And he is active in the Socialist Left Party, was about to be deputy. And he's from Israel originally. He's a spokesman to ship to Gaza. So this Mavi Marmara, when it was killed 11 people or 12 by Israeli defense forces, he was there actually. And he's president of a European Jews for Peace. Very colorful, very interesting person. So we talk about how actually he combines such a uncompromised experimental noise music with his political activism, like in Gaza, you know, they go to Gaza and all these things. And he's all the time in with the refugees, and he's a leader of anti-fascist front in Sweden. Like, for example, if fascists want to demonstrate, they immediately gather together 6,000 people against. Another thing related I will talk about is from Mazen Kerbaj, originally from Beirut. He made a piece called Starry Night. You can watch in internet, listen, pardon, in internet. I don't want to play now. He recorded it so when in 2006, June, Israel was bombing Beirut. He went to balcony. He's an experimental musician. And he has a prepared trumpet. So you cannot control notation. It's distorted, out of sync. And there was a bombs coming, and he used them as a contingent, aleatory drums, percussion, that he imagined them, which he improvised with his trumpet. So there is an aggression as a drums by the one state to another, which artist is improvising with his trumpet anyway. And there is a very long text by Ozren Pupovac analyzing this. So I am not contradicting myself saying, but there is a text about artwork. It is not explaining an artwork. It is he is a philosopher, Ozren, thinks in which way this strong work challenges his philosophical thinkings, his Badiouist, let's say like that. His understanding of state, of index, of subjectivity. He let the artwork enter to his philosophy and to shatters. You know, he challenges and pushes forward. There are a few other things I don't want to bother so much. In the second issue, also there are some interviews. One is with Darko Suvin, who is now 85 years old. Lives in Italy, Yugoslavian, expert on science fiction, on Brecht, and then there is interview with Peter Gidal. Peter Gidal is a structuralist, materialist filmmaker, very important from 70s, and he has a book called Materialist Film. And there is Christine Delphi. She's a Marxist feminist. And her text is called here Continuities and Discontinuities in Marriage and Divorce. We put this text republished, and we got permission from Verso. Now it's available, now Verso published. It's called Closer to Home. And wait Christmas, everything will be 50% with Verso. Postage included. So she is very interesting feminist theoretician. And what she analyzed, and what for us as a art formal orientation was important, is that you cannot just make experimental art and thinking that you easily divorce, easily break from the conventional narrative language. It demands a bit more. And her text is dealing, saying like, actually woman who divorced from man does not divorce the a man ideology. You know, divorcing is very difficult for women, because what is persisting is not only what is persisting as a man's ideology is not only to that figure of a man which she was living with, but it's something else, you know, even like can be also other women's, the understanding how genders should be. And her research is on the reproduction of capitalism in these gender relations. Very interesting. Now she published a book called Separate and Rule, or I forgot exact title, but available in English, about a public discourse on the Fereja, the burqa in France. and how all the racist things comes out. So this was noise, and then third issue, I will show something just came out. This one I leave a lot of copies. I will not talk many things, just like two examples. And one is very interesting, maybe you know these guys. They are from Belgrade, Vladan Jeremić and Rena Radde. Why is that? Oh, it's stuck. Doesn't matter. Okay, I showed like you have in your hand. So this is the red okay. And now something. Anyway, we are approaching to the end slowly, but it is in socialist Yugoslavia. There was it is a big factory of making like steel, and then they were inviting every year here artists. Actually, not such a good colors. This here are better. Inviting artists to work with the workers and create art, but not a figurative representation, very abstract art. You know, that was in Yugoslavia socialist art. Non-figurative abstract art was official art. And so these are now left on the side, decaying, and nobody takes care. So they went there, made a talk with the workers, and workers are still kind of identifying with that moment, that subjectivity of like, yes, we did those, and we are also artists, you know, like, workers, being worker in this message is not only objective condition. Yeah, I have my job, I get my money, and this and that. It's something more. It's also this subjectivity of this production of that feeling of collectivity, of whatever, of feeling of getting rid of your feudal past, and, you know, it's also about modernism and things. It's all on that. Then there are again Darko Subin's text, first time we publish in English, about reading the strange poetic references in Communist Manifesto of horror things and strange fantastic stuff. Interesting thing here that I would now like to talk, or if you have something is here. I know why, because this is a very high, big file, you know, it takes time. Okay, I managed to jump. There is a Bini Adamczak, queer activist, her text on the communism for children. She wrote it in German, but now it's coming as an English translation from MIT Press next year. We publish excerpt together with 13 ways of avoiding ideological interpolation. Then we have I really want to show this because something, I guess. A lot of contributions are. This is so far our, let's say, best issue. you know, if I am allowed to say that. You know, these are a lot of things on cinema, experimental cinema, and forms, and the temporality, like written by the filmmakers themselves. Here is. So, Ketevan Kinturashvili, she is an art historian, curator, based in Tbilisi. Very interesting researcher. And her lifetime work is David Kakabadze, paint artist from Tbilisi, who Menshevik Republic of Georgia sent him to Paris in 1922 to study the most advanced art works there and to come and teach in Tbilisi in Paris. And when he went to Paris, he started to follow cinema, then avant-garde cinema, and he made an experiment. He made a big project of three-dimensional cinema. He even patented and found a rich patron that would finance that, but they bankrupt. And he couldn't do it. So in 27, he was devastated. Even his works was bought by Société Anonyme, by some French advanced journals wrote about him. He, 27, said, okay, I return to Georgia. And when he returned, there was already things different. It was not Mensheviks anymore. It was very much like Russian-ruled Bolshevik. Let's say, you know, I don't go to the history now. And he got the jobs, but more and more in the 30s, he was criticized as formalist because he was experimental. Like, you are formalist, you can never get rid of your formalism past. And formalism in Russia meant it's very bad word, like a swear word. If you are formalist, you are finished, no job. And then 40s, he tried to make big paintings of Stalin, of everything, Lenin, couldn't succeed. And he came up with an idea to make a three-dimensional representation of Stalin. It would be like a 12 plates. When you put a light, would be hologrammatic Stalin. And so we reproduced here. It looked like this. So it doesn't make sense because it makes sense if it works in the two pages. You see, like these are Stalin. And if you put light on it, it will come his picture. But here you cannot see it. This is David Kakabadze. And but this is the most interesting thing. He didn't get support from the state to do this project. He was hoping he will get support, all the jobs and things. They said, yes, content is okay, Stalin, you know, and the way, but form is not good. So, I mean, even if content is fine, it's a representation and glorification of Stalin, if the way how it's done is a problematic, also for the state can be a problem. And can be something that is subversive. So this is like another thing here in this issue is a long interview with John Roberts on Hegel and art and language and conceptual art theory. But and I have one art piece I did in Ljubljana first time. It's on hardcore punk. It's a 13 theses on hardcore punk. What's the form of hardcore punk? And the way how I did it, you know, the punk's images are usually, they are leaning to the wall somewhere, and it's a brick walls, like in Clash, in the Crass, in the all like punk and hardcore. And I select photos of that, punk photos, and crop the part which you cannot see. No sign, no any sociological sign, no any historical sign, just the brick walls. So they are all cut from the, here would be like, I don't know, Ramones or Petty Smith. I don't know, Eus Ars actually, I cut from a lot of hardcore bands. And imposed on them is these 13 slogans. Another similar thing is a reinterpretation of a suprematism by Ilya Orlov. They are all fell down. There's gravity working on, but his theory on the concept of eclipse in Malevich is something. And then it's a big interview with Margarita Tupitsin. She wrote a few very good books on Russian avant-garde, especially her book Malevich and Film is a big topic of the discussion. Here is, and. This is interview with Kazimir Malevich. It's a Belgrade artist from 86 who sent a letter to Art in America criticizing postmodern appropriation of Black Square. So it's with him, and then small statements by Badiou, and then other stuff. Yeah. So this is Our latest issue just came a month ago. I have 10 copies here. And now we are making the new one, which will be ready, I guess, in spring. And we are starting to make books with a Rabra press. It's actually, it is, yes, each volume is a special topic, but you know, for us it's important, these are not like topics, because there is no, I mean, I edit these things. I don't like to work, for example, to send the open call or to say somebody, hey, we are making the issue on, let's say, forest. This was forest, has nothing to do with forest. Forest because Karl Marx in 1842 was writing a book on art after he finished his PhD. And then he, while writing this book on art, because he couldn't get a job in university anywhere in Germany at that time, and he said, okay, I write a book on art. And then he got something to write for this Rheinische Zeitung. And he wrote a book, first text for that is looting the forests, you know, theft of the wood from the forests. And with that text on the forest, analyzing the forest, Karl Marx became communist. He realized, it's a long story, it's intro, I detailed, explained in detail. Marx realized that Hegel, which he was Hegelian, Hegel's understanding of civil society and everything is insufficient to explain how this forest is privatized, you know. So he had another thing, like a violence of state, and arrived to this communist theory. But text is very indicative to a transition period. That is, Marx was writing book on art, and he was very much into art. And article, the text on forest, is full with artistic references, very artistic. And he comes up with a, he proposed a different kind of abstraction, more, it's called a coarse abstraction, like more angry and things like that. So yes, topics, but more allusions, you know, more like a red thread. And the next red thread, a line is something we call formalism, formaoism, you know, and it is about how to represent a people, a mass, a collective that is uprising, you know, in the riots, in like now everywhere, people are uprising, people are declaring themselves in the historical stage. But it's, when you look art, I think it's really lagging behind what is happening in the world. Like, people are in the streets, and 2016 was the year where was a lot of people in the streets. 2017 will be even more. That's where it will not resolve by itself, you know. So we really are now going to big research and a big study of, I mean, big study meaning among us, we talk, read and talk. And how actually, what are the images, words, sounds that could be more appropriate, more related to this people's uprising, people's revolt. And why formalism for Maoism? Because Mao always said, and Chinese revolution, cultural revolution, pardon, great Chinese, Chinese great cultural revolution, always was claiming that uprising is a beautiful, you know, always revolt. And this is our starting point. So how to formalize, why to formalize this? Because formalism is again here a shortcut, a more theoretical approach of a thing that we don't want to talk in that moralistic terms, like, yeah, people, you know, when you go to moralistic terms, values and things like, look at, people are now stuck, you know, you can talk with leftists, even liberals and stuff. You say like immigrants, you know, yes, but you know, they are so violent, you know, like look at what they did in Köln, attack to women, you know, gender inequality. Like you know, people don't cannot make their mind actually. What do they think about this? Millions of refugees now, and then the European values and this and that. I'm not talking about neo-Nazis and fascists and all those bastards, but even the leftist liberal people are a bit like shocked in many ways. Like, because, you know, when you think with this kind of very spontaneous culturalist terms, you can't get to real point. And the real point, I think, is has to be something else. But what is it? You know, that's why formalism. So that to formalize that we can talk about it without feeling embarrassed, ashamed. You know, you can say, but this is all learning. Nobody has a ready answer of this situation. This is happening now. You know, nobody's. This is completely new form, new thing, and it will take time, but it is important decision. Yeah, we want to understand this, we want to know this. And I think art is, because art is not something which should be functional, should be in the service of a state, of institutions, but art is completely this subjective position, it's kind of very creative in that. Creative, I hate that word, but I think art has a lot to offer in here. Not as a art works, art objects, exhibitions, but thinking like in that terms, thinking outside of objective conditions. So that's our next plans, and we have a lot of books actually now coming, dealing. I don't want now to be talking about those anyway, they are abstract. To talk, but mostly are dealing these different experiments of engaging with revolts, riots, and all that things that are consequences of this political, historical moments. Yeah, that was, I think, more or less. I mean, I am not going to art and language now. I'm a bit tired, and I think it will be very confusing after all these things. But if you have any question, please ask something. Or we can just talk, you know. That. Thank you. Yes.